Okay, good evening, everybody. Nice punctual start. I'm very delighted to introduce Werner Sobek and welcome him to the AA. This is your first visit, I think.
It is.
To the AA, so we're very honoured to have you here. Werner, I should say my name is Samantha. For those of you who don't know, so I'm Samantha Hardingham. I'm a diploma tutor in Diploma 7. And I was very taken by Werner's writing, actually. Werner is both an architect and an engineer, and those two things sit very closely together. He's neither one nor the other, but both together, and that's very important to know. And he was just reasserting that to me, which is, I think it is important to reassert. I was introduced to him through his writing, which I think is possibly quite unusual. For me, it was unusual to be introduced to certainly the engineering side of somebody's brain through writing. And it was a particular article called Architecture Isn't Here to Stay, which I have to say in its own right was a very captivating title. And I was intrigued. And the first line of his essay says, frankly, I can no longer stand the words sustainability, which in itself is going to grab you for the rest of the article. Nevertheless, the rest of the article is an extremely good read and ends, the buildings we design today should therefore have the ability at the very least to leave the planet respectably. Now, what happens in between is what I hope so Werner will begin to explain a little bit about. But I must say that the other reason why I was really taken by the article was it was the first time in a long time I'd heard or read an architect or an engineer talk about this specific issue of the idea of architecture not being something that sticks with us forever. It's a sort of anti-monumental tract, and that was in relation to my own interest, which is in the work of Cedric Price, who was specifically, it made the Avery spring to mind, his own work in writing a government report on air structures in the 70s, where he did a comprehensive international survey of lightweight structures, not as far as I know, that's been done again since, quite so comprehensively, and also that he was the only architect member of the National Federation of Demolition Contractors, which is what then made me look at Werner's subtitle, which says, towards a reversibility of construction. And I'm not entirely sure the two things really marry, but certainly they got me thinking. Anyway, Werner is a eminent figure, head of the Institute of Lightweight Structures in Stuttgart, was a professor at the Chicago, IIT in Chicago, and is now head of what he was now listing all of the countries where the practice, his office, now have new offices, which virtually covers most of the globe. So we are really honoured to have him here, to have you made time to come see us. So I will hand over to you. Thank you.
Thank you, Samantha, for your nice welcoming words, and hello to everyone. Maybe I add some things to give you a background on why we are doing what we are doing. So as Samantha already told you that I studied architecture and structural engineering in Stuttgart, and at the time when I did so, I took much more time than the people urged me to take. So I said, why should I finish my studies in 5 years? I'm hopefully getting 90 years older or even longer. So I take the chance at the university to grab know-how wherever I can. So I studied aircraft design, car body design, textile engineering, and all that somehow came together. So my colleagues always told me that I will never get a job because what I studied was far too complicated and avant-garde. However, it did not work out that badly. So I founded my company, my engineering and design office, about 22 years ago as a one-man company, and now we are working with 200 people more or less all around the world. So we have architects, product designers, industrial designers, glass specialists, we have structural engineers, we even have aircraft engineers and historians, working in a total embedment of interdisciplinary approach, because I think this is the only way to start when we are going out to solve the problems of tomorrow's world. And parallel to this, I'm lucky to head the Institute for Lightweight Structures, which is an abbreviation, it is Lightweight Structures and Conceptual Design in Stuttgart, which was formerly two institutes. The one was originated in the architectural department, founded and headed by the famous Frei Otto, an architect researching and contributing to the world of know-how of science and lightweight structures. He retired in 91 and I got his successor. I was his teacher and got his successor in 95. And later on, there was a second big branch in Stuttgart where we had the first chair in the world for the science of concrete structures, founded in 1916 by Emil Mörsch, who was Swiss and Swabian, Swiss and German, worked in both countries. And the institute, this concrete structure research institute, was headed after Emil Mörsch by the famous Fritz Leonhard, one of the most eminent engineers in the 20th century, successed by Jörg Schleich. And finally, the university urged me to take over. I resisted for 6 months, but then I could not any longer, so I had two institutes and two chairs. The one was architecture, the other one was engineering, and then I unified them in a symbolic act in order to overcome the gap between the two disciplines and to make it clear to everyone that we have to teach at the same, in the same lectures, with the same designs, with the same problems to both faculties, at least to both faculties. And this, we are doing this very successful with 36 full-time assistants, many, many doctoral students reaching out to research the problems of the day after tomorrow. So we are not talking in my university institute about applied research. This is just not interesting for us. I think the most noble job of a university professor, of a chair holder, is to do research in the field of unknown, taking the risk to fail, which is typically not the case when you do applied research. So why this introduction? Because you need to understand why we ask the questions a little bit more fundamental from a bigger distance. This diagram is known to everyone, at least since 1974, where we saw it the first time in the publication of Club of Rome. It talks about the explosion of the population, which we do not really feel, because here in Central Europe we talk about shrinking and negative fertility rates, etc., etc. But if you ask the question, how many people are younger than 16? You are just in the steep part of the curve. How many are younger than 16 means how many millions or billions still stay at home, walk to the kindergarten, eat at home, sleep at home. And this is 2.2 billions. So, okay, what does this mean? 2.2 billions was the world's population in 1930. So that means that in the next 16 years, once those 2.2 billion kids are leaving home, we have to provide them with some shelters, apartments, housing, with a working place and an infrastructure. Means we have to build the world of 1930 once more in 16 years, which is impossible. A second aspect is, if we would do so, then we would build it to the standards of 1930, which means every German, the average German person per capita had less than square meter of living space. Nowadays they have 42. So if we would do it to the standards of today, then we would have to build the world of 1930 2.5 times, 3 times, which is even more impossible. So the question is, what are we going to do? Leave those young people homeless, unsheltered? Or what are we providing for them? Are we going to build cities like this? This would be more the Central European approach, because at least the Germans don't like high-rise buildings. They stop at maximum 4 to 5 stories. So if you provide living space for 2.2 billion people in 4-story buildings, it ends with that. Not talking about the mobility, the individual mobility needed to run that, let's call it, system. Not to talk about the consumption of resources or waste. Building industry stands for 60% of the consumption of resources, 60. In Europe, in North America, the building industry stands for 60% of the mass waste production. It stands for 35% of the energy consumption and for more than 35% of the CO2 emissions. CO2 emissions related to the production of concrete are more than the entire world's air traffic. So what are we going to do? Continuing as we did in the last decades? Of course not, because it's quite obviously that it does not work. There were approaches following these reports of the Club of Rome. For example, in Germany, Swiss, Scandinavian countries, Austrian, where the government said, okay, we at least reduce the primary energy heating consumption stepwise over the years, beginning with an average number of 260-65 in 1980 and driving it down to whatever the magic number of 100. It is quite obvious that the avant-garde, the technological avant-garde, was always better. This is the solar houses, the low energy houses, the 3-liter house, the zero energy house, the plus energy buildings, and so on. What has been built in the meantime is here. It is new buildings, not the existing one. It's new one. Which is not that much, but at least the effort took place. What happened? By all that effort, which cost endless money, in Germany, we were able, since 1900 and, let's say, 70, 75, to reduce that heating energy demand per square meter from 5,000 to nowadays something like 3,000. So it is a reduction of 40%. Applause. At the same time, the square meter per person, per capita, doubled. So if we look at the right units and don't talk about kilowatt hours per square meter and year, but just on the number per capita, the heating energy demand is more or less the same than 40 years ago. All those billions and billions invested in the form of better heating systems, better cooling systems, insulation wrapped around the buildings, actually up to 30, 40 centimeters in Germany, was more or less nothing else than a resultless effort. We can take another view on political intentions. German government announced at around 2000 to improve the thermal behavior of all the existing residential buildings in the next 50 years with a rate of 2% per year, down from the actual consumption to a reduction of 70%, which is really something. Now, I ask the question, what does this really mean? Turning the entire built environment in the residentials in Germany into that low energy for heating consumption. Very simple. In Germany, we have 40 million apartments and detached houses, out of which about 35 million need an energetic rehabilitation. The average German apartment size is 82 square meters. Quite luxurious. 41 per person. But that's the status. And the same, the numbers are true for all Central Europe, maybe except London. Now the question is, what is the cost of a thermal energetic rehabilitation? It ranks between 500 and 1,500 euros per square meter. 500 is a non-realistic political number. 1,500 comes relatively close to the truth. But in order to be, let's say, not attackable, to be very, very conservative in our statement, we say, okay, let's do a calculation with 500. 500 euro per square meter. And then multiply 35 millions by 82 by 500, and the sum is 1,400 billion euros. This is an amount of money where you can rescue Greece twice, Italy twice, Spain, Great Britain, France, and including Germany several times. It is a number which is unpayable, which is not financiable. So the question is, what should we do? And this is true not only for Germany, it's true for Central Europe. Even those super rich countries cannot afford this, because it means an increase of the monthly rent of about 200 to 250 euro per apartment, an increase. And if you are, let's say, a lower income person in Germany, living from pension funds, you typically make about 600 to 1200 euros per month. Now, actually, you already pay 120 for heating per month. Now you should pay another 250. This is socially undoable. So if even the rich countries cannot afford it, how should we deal that problem in Italy, in China, in India? And this is the question we are asking ourselves. And of course, we don't have the answers, but we heavily attack them with totally different approaches than approaches seen before, at least in some aspects. There are some categories which we are following. The one is the strict minimalization of the consumption of resources by turning everything we are doing into lightweight structures. The second is doing everything, combining those materials to a building in a way that it is at least fully recyclable. The third thing is to reduce the energy consumption during lifetime, but not only during lifetime, also in the what we call the begin of life phase, where you need plenty of energy to produce the material, to make the building parts out of it, and to install it. In a typical Central European residential building, a detached house, the embodied energy means the energy needed before you turn the key the first time is the equivalent of about 25 to 35 years of runtime. So it makes a lot of sense to reduce the embodied energy before we talk about making every building airtight. The building society, architects and engineers, in an not understandable way, for me not understandable, just neglect those aspects. They don't talk about the amount of embodied energy. They don't talk about the energy needed in the end of life phase. They don't talk about precious metals, rare metals, which you need to make steel out of iron. And even the German government has not realized yet that we are running out of petroleum in minimum 20 years. When they wrap styrofoam insulation around the buildings in 2040, they try to do something to reduce the light oil consumption at a point in time when there is no oil out there anymore. Now, I don't want to be the negative utopist, not at all. I'm just a very modest scientist. This is the one jacket I'm wearing, the jacket of the scientist, dealing with very precise, very well-known numbers. So, however, when we try to reduce the consumption of materials, we have to look, on the one hand side, for a very effective building parts, structures, which at the end still have to be aesthetically outstanding, because nobody wants to live in a world which is aesthetically not satisfying. So we are very lucky to work with most of the most famous architects in the world together. This is Hans Hollein from Vienna, where we, in this case, acting as engineers, sometimes we act as engineers, sometimes as product designers, sometimes etc., etc., installed a facade here for this private bank, the Interbank in Lima in Peru, which is made out of titanium, the largest titanium application ever. what you can't see is the thinness of the pipes which run diagonally here, spatially curved, 50 millimeter diameter titanium pipes, in total 27 kilometers. The single span, the biggest span here, is 14 meter of a titanium pipe. And in order to add sense to that, and to really make clear that this is the more sense-making decision than to have something out of regular steel or of stainless steel, we drove the wall thickness of those pipes down to 0.5, sometimes to 0.2 millimeters. So at the very end, this shading element turning the entire building into a sculpture was cheaper than doing it in stainless steel. We installed everything in a 100% recyclable technique, and it was cheaper than a stainless steel solution. So in this search, not to use titanium because it sounds somehow fantastic, also to use titanium from a scientific standpoint because it makes sense, we also researched those things, which is the tallest carbon fiber structure ever built. This is more than 50 meters high, very thin-walled carbon fiber tubes. It is a sculpture designed by the artist Rita McBride from New York, which had been installed in Munich, Germany. So the thinness, the lightness of those structural elements forming that sculpture may be seen from this. We are looking up from ground to a height of 50 meters, and you see this, you watch the slenderness of the structure. As we saving material by at the same time adding an evolving, what I call self-beauty, is originated here. This is a big atrium for an insurance company. The architect is Christoph Ingenhofen, a close friend of ours, where we have columns with a clear span of 40 meters. Only four columns are supporting this huge roof, which has a square-sized glass panels, all identical size, insulated, of course, and blah, blah, blah. And the only thing we did is we designed it in such a way that the height of those structural elements follows the flow of forces, means they are becoming higher and therefore more powerful where they meet the column's head, and in between they are more or less disappear. So it's a very, very simple approach, which yields to this self-evolving beauty, because this is an inner logic which then results after many, many steps of optimizing such structures. So look at this. What should you add? There's nothing to be added. Of course, we have to work in a very precise way. All the elements are very slender. They are of the same width. All the details are identical. And this also drives the costs down, which is a basis to make that realizable. Because actually, nowadays, the clients are not willing, typically, to pay that much for such glass roofs, as they did 15 years ago before the so-called internet bubble. This is also a very nice example for finding in a close cooperation with all the other ones involved in the design of a structure, a solution which on the one hand side allows a breathtaking span, a clear span of 140 meters with cantilevers of 45 meters on each side to support a roof which is close to 800 meters long with 22 columns only. By just forming the height of this very trivial truss so that it follows the line of moments, the lines of inner loading, where we have a negative moment, where we have a positive moment, where we have a negative moment again. And using those techniques, we drive the amount of material needed down to the absolute minimum. As we did here. This was one of the first exercises we did with facades. This is a facade 40 meters high, 1,000 meter long in total, huge glass panes, and to hold that all in space, we did, now looking upwards from the floor, these, in the middle of the 90s, very fashionable cable trusses. It is relatively effective. At those times, we were quite proud that we were able to do that especially in that huge size, and make it working under the heavy wind loads you find there. But at the very end, once we did this a couple of times, we said, okay, there is nothing worse than drilling a hole into a piece of glass, because you cause stress concentrations around that fixing point. And now this is typical for us. If we realize that, if we say from the standpoint of lightweight engineering, means from the standpoint of someone using all the materials in a way that they have a very homogeneous loading, that there is no concentration of stresses, there is no singularity allowed, we say, okay, no drillings anymore. Then we had to invent something different. And then we also said, okay, do we really need all that? The world said, yes, this is the optimum. And I said, no, we leave minimum 60% away. Let's search a solution where we just have one cable, vertical cable, and nothing more. So this is what came out of it. This is in a university center in the northern part of Germany. They call that a central hall. This is where the students meet in the morning hours, have an espresso, talk a little bit, and then leave to take the lectures. It's 60 meters long, 18 meters high, and this is the first structure ever built where you have just vertical cables with a spacing of 2 meters, which are pre-stressed by springs here, visible springs, because it's a university, so the student should ask themselves, what is this? Obviously pre-stressed. And where the cables have a thinness of 20 millimeters, spanning over 18 meters high, and this is all we have. Like the strings of a harp, highly pre-stressed, and then we just clip the glass onto that. So now remember, the thickness to height is 20 millimeters to 18,000, so it's 1 to 900. Normally you have 1 to 30. If you have a very good engineer, you have 1 to 50. If he comes around with 1 to 80, he's probably not that good. Now in this case, we have 1 to 900. This only works because we allow for huge deformations. So this facade moves inwards, outwards, under heavy wind loadings, like 100 miles an hour, of about 400 millimeters. Inwards, but slowly, it breathes, which is fine as long as you are able to predict that and to design all the details in a way that the glass does not break. So the client was very anxious when my people told them that it moves 400 millimeters inside. I told him, if you would be a mountain climber, dear client, then you would know that 100 miles an hour, nobody's looking at the facade. So we got even keener, and we did this one, which is an 8-story high window, 8 stories high, 8 stories wide, which is held in place by vertical cables only. So the black lines you see, this is the silicon joints between the glass. The silicon joints are wider than the diameter of the cables is. So we talk about structures which are more or less invisible, which are so light that their engineering becomes very, very complicated. But nowadays, if you have the right engineers, it's of course doable and works perfect. If you continue to reduce, this is the question we ask. At our institute in Stuttgart, we have our own garden around the institute. And there we have a couple of experimental shells and other buildings still standing. So this is the thinnest glass shell ever built. The diameter is 8.50 meters, and the thinness, the thickness is 10 millimeters. So it is 10 millimeters to 8,500, which is a 20th of the relation as you find them in an eggshell. So here we are very close to work with paper. Of course, the shell undergoes compression loadings, typically. It's relatively effective. Is of course not allowed to buckle. Nowadays we would be even keener and would say, okay, we can do that even by 6 millimeters. And if we would not use a spherical shell but something undulated, we could even do it with 4 millimeters. With the same safety to be provided for the people standing on the shell or playing below it. But before I come back to this approach of defining structural systems which are so effective that we do not need that much material, I want to do a small journey into the air-supported things. This is the first building I ever did, where I signed all the calculations of. This was in France, in the heart of France, in Nîmes, La Couverture Temporaire des Arènes de Nîmes. So this was a Roman arena, which was a national monument, so every stone was protected. You were not allowed to drill any hole into something. And this structure was a seasonal structure, which has been built in for 14 years. In October, once the tourists left, stood there over the winter time, and was taken out, disassembled, in March, April, before the tourists came. So this was the city hall of the people of Nîmes, because they never had a war, so there was no destroyment there in this city founded by the Romans already. And instead of having a city hall at the perimeter of the town, they said, why don't we use Les Arènes? But of course, since it's a national monument, we can use it, and we need it only during wintertime. So we installed this. Let's call it a building with a clear span of 90 meter by 60 meters. It is an air-inflated cushion formed by a textile membrane on the top and one on the bottom. So it's a lentil-type thing, somehow elliptic in plan. Now, this is the first time where I worked with air as a load-bearing element, because if it snows and they have heavy snowfalls there, in total 360 metric tons of snow need to be supported by that air-supported piece of fabric, which is only 1 millimeter thick, which has a weight of 1 kilogram per square meter, and which spans 60 by 90 meters. So that's doable. We know the principle from the air-supported halls. This is now an air-inflated structure. And we needed that lightness to bridge that span with something which can be folded away in April, stored over the summertime, then in October brought into the arena, unfolded, brought up, and inflated. But once we got experienced enough with the handling of this, once we got this fingertip feeling, what is doable and where we do we better stand away, we were keen enough to do just the opposite. This is the first vacuum facade ever built. Following the principle of absolute radical ability to be deployed and recycled, having no glue, no bolt, nothing, we said, okay, for this piece protecting a national monument, which is the saddest place in Germany, it's the concentration camp Sachsenhausen. And even in this sad place, the worstest place was obviously here, was mostly destroyed, but there were still a couple of fragmented walls and iron girders sticking out of the ground, and the German government said we have to weather protect this, so we asked for a roof with a clear span of 40 by 50 meters, which protects those parts. And it was quite obvious that in this international architectural competition, you had to expect engineered solutions which were very sensational, because 40 by 50 meters is already something. And we said, we do not want to have an engineered sensation here. We want to have the maximum of simplicity and modesty. The best we should have is, we stated this in the first design session, a translucent coverage which has no detail. So how are you going to do this? Something where there is no visible detail. We said we installed a relatively simple steel space frame. Then we mount gratings on the outer as well as on the inner surfaces with a mesh size of 60 by 60 millimeters. And then we arrive with prefabricated pieces of several thousand square meter size fabric. We clamp it here invisible and airtight onto the steel structure, throw it over the roof and clamp it on the other side. And we do the same for the inner surfaces. So after installing all these fabrics, we had one thrown over the roof, airtightly connected, and then we had another one quite wrinkled below it, also clamped. And then we evacuated the air in between the two pieces. So what you see here, or here, this textile piece, 2,000 square meter, plus the walls, everything is held in place by negative pressure. And since this coated fabric is so airtight, and since the clamping devices are so good, we need only the energy of such a small pump, and this pump needs the energy of equivalent 8 square meters of photovoltaic. And at the point in time when we decide, or the upcoming generations, that this is the worstest thing ever built, and they want to destroy it, they just switch off the pressure pump. And then within hours, this very light fabric falls down. You detach it, roll it up, and recycle it, or build a tent out of it. So this is recyclability, lightweight, very conscious treatment of energies needed in the begin of life phase, the operational phase, and the end of life phase. And this is how we work. See, this is detail-free. Several thousand square meters of sheer white, translucent, and absolutely detail-free. No bolts, no whatever. And of course, this is the one thing then, the absolute perfect surface, but we still study then the other options, like, and this is a big advantage of paper as well as of fabric, its ability to be folded. Yeah. Normally the textile structures in the last decades, everyone tried to make it wrinkle-free. This was the big thing. Is there a wrinkle? No, good engineering. I said, the textile lives from its folding seams and wrinkles. If you look at the designs of the Grand Couturiers, except maybe some of the catsuits, but everything else is nothing else than a very artistic arrangement of seams and wrinkles. So we said, did our great teachers totally forget that, and when they didn't they go into the totally wrong direction with their wrinkle-free, perfectly stressed stuff? So we started working with foldings. Look at this, structures like this, which then can be held in place by negative pressure, of course, as we already saw it, etc., etc. And this then brought us, of course, to the question, why don't we do textile facades? And since the physical properties, the building physical properties, are relatively weak, there is no sound insulation, there is no thermal insulation of a single layer, the idea was to study multi-layer facades as a combination of different qualities with a different level of pre-stress, with different air chambers in between, developing framing techniques which do not act as a thermal bridge, etc., etc. Then the question, can we make them breathable in a micro size or in a meso size like this? So these are openings with a 100 millimeter width. It's relatively simple. We just slotted the fabric and we sewed air pipes on the upper as well as on the lower edge. And the air pipes are woven in such a way that the upper half of the cross section is a soft fiber and the lower half is a stiff fiber. So they are straight, but as soon as you inflate them, the stiff fibers don't elongate, but the soft ones do. So they start forming a banana. This is all the trick behind that. But this allows you to transfer or to install an adaptivity into our building skins. You just have to be aware of one fact. We talk about a house. So what do we see if we talk about a house? There's inside the house the people. There's no people, there's one person, there are many persons, they are active, they are non-active at sleeping. So there's a very dynamic change of the situation inside. And outside it's the same. We have day and night, we have summer and winter, we have sun and snow and rain and whatever. So it's a super dynamic loading from outside as well as from inside. And we answer with a building skin with constant physical properties. From a scientific standpoint, this is total nonsense. To have a dynamic system inside and a dynamic system outside, and to separate them with something which has constant physical properties. So what we need is an adaptivity of that skin. It must be breathable, we need a switchable light transmission, we need a switchable energy absorption, we need a switchable energy storage and release option. The only thing we invented in 5,000 years is what we call in Germany the Rollladen, or the Fensterladen, that's all. Not very much, if we count all the architects and engineers which dealt with the problem. So at the end, we do so. And sometimes we are quite successful. So this thing got patented, is now produced in huge series. It's the first, let's say, blower, air blower, which when it is not active, does not act as a thermal bridge. All the other ones do. And of course, in our work, we take advantage of the fact when we work with textiles, that this is the only building material which is high quality, light, and foldable. So its foldability might be nicely used, for example, for this design, which we did with Kurokawa Senior, still, which is a movable stadium's roof over a soccer stadium in St. Petersburg. Still under construction, but this is another story. Now I'm coming back to this. Just to make you, let's say, to explain how we think. You may say this is total nonsense, but I'm here to tell you why and how. So if you look at this, you already learned the thickness to span ratio is a 20th of an eggshell. And it's absolutely robust. It stands in the garden of our institute since more than 10 years. The scientists are crawling on top of it on the weekends, the kids, and don't ask what happened with it. It is fully snow and wind loaded. Sometimes you even don't see the shell because it's totally under snow. And we did it for the first time ever without any metallic element connecting the 44 pieces of double curved glass. This is a glue which we developed in the context with a doctoral thesis together with 3M, the glue manufacturer. It's a butt type of joint, and everyone feared that we have creeping in this plastic glue, etc., etc., which did not happen. So it works perfect, but it is something with constant physical properties. And the design, the engineering design, had been done taking into account loading cases, 200, 300 loading cases, full snow, symmetrical, half side, quarter side, south, quarter side, north, etc., wind from there, wind from there. And the structure was unable to react. It just had to take it. And as plenty of loading cases where, if you would be able to look inside the glass, you have a very inhomogeneous loading, not to say stress concentrations. Being an engineer, you always have to size such a shell after the highest stress occurring somewhere. So here we have this, I'm talking about stress fields, which is nothing else. A field, this comes from the mathematics, is over a certain area the distribution of a value. So if the value on the surface of the shell is a stress, we talk about a stress field. And the stress field is homogeneous if the stress is everywhere the same, and it is non-homogeneous if we have peaks and valleys, etc. So normal life is non-homogeneous. Means there are overloaded and upper and underloaded elements. But if you want to do the absolute optimum, then you do not want to have elements which are not fully loaded. So the question is there a chance, is there a ability somewhere to create a structure which is fully loaded at every point of its surface under any loading condition? I asked that question about 25 years ago. I did not find the answer. And once I gave a lecture, I made this, and it became clear to me what we have to do. Because everyone would say each of the five fingers takes the same load, half the weight of my arm, which is true only on the first side, because if this one is relatively clever, it relaxes the muscles and doesn't do anything. And the same is true for this and for this. So the worstest case is that one finger has to take everything, or all the five take their part. And this brought me to the idea to integrate artificial muscles into such buildings and to manipulate those muscles in a way that they release or contract through influencing the stress field in a shell. Means, if this is the thinnest arch ever thinkable, which stands under its dead weight, but it's so unbelievable thin that as soon as you have a non-symmetric loading, it collapses this way. You just need some artificial muscles or another technique within the arch which bumps it backwards into the stable position. So this has to be counterbalanced with something like this, and the addition of both is that. So nobody believed that. So we built it. We did a lot of theory, which was quite complicated, mathematical-wise, of course. And then, since the scientific community still did not believe what we said, we built the thinnest wood shell ever. We are quite keen. We always risk collapses, because no risk, no fun. So we said, from here to here, it's 10 meters over the diagonal, it's 14 meters. And we did this shell with a thickness of 40 millimeter of very cheap wood, spruce. Normally, you would do it with 200 millimeters. Being already somehow keen, we did it with 40. So it's quite obvious, the shell stands there, looks quite nice, but as soon as you have, for example, a half-side snow loading, it collapses. And then we said, okay, we need to know when it collapses. We need to know something about the stress field. We cannot measure stresses, but we measure deformations. So on 14 points of the shell, we measure the deformations. So we have numbers somewhere. And from those 14 points, we calculate the deformation field. Every deformation at every point in every direction in real time. And once we have the deformation field, we know about the stress field. And once we know about the stress field under the natural loading, we calculate the counterbalance stress field. And then we ask ourselves the question, how can we install that? Now we are not that far still now with those embedded muscles, still working on them. But what we did in this case, we have four supports. One is rigid, three are movable. And we move those points in the space in such a way, it's only a few millimeters, that they artificially deform the wooden shell in a way that the resulting stress field is exactly the counterbalancing one to the natural one. So now you see a stress field for the very first time. This is a stress field showing the size of the stresses under a certain type of loading, and you immediately see, okay, this is the hell. The wood will never take it. The wood takes a number of 20, this is already the limit. Here everything is very homogeneous. See, this is a projection of the shell to the XY plane. Here everything is fine, but here we have those peak stresses which will make the legs breaking, these wooden elements which sit on the cylinders. And now we create this artificial and overlay it, and this is the result. Everything very homogeneous, no peaks. By a very simple trick. And this allows us to save 80% of material. So what we are doing is we replace material by energy. And we clearly say these very extreme loading cases, they might occur one times per year, one times per decade, and so on. Why should we install material which is needed one twinkle of your eyes within a decade? We just leave that off. and have some somehow intelligent. Okay, the mechanism is never intelligent. The architect and the engineer has to be intelligent, which then answers to that load attack, if we call it that way. So here, this is the demonstration mode. It moves relatively, look at this, up to 300 millimeters. In reality, this is 3-4 millimeters, not more. As one approach, we saw about adaptivity in textile skins. We see a small story about adaptivity in load-bearing structures, and we are researching this phenomenon of adaptivity, overcoming the constant physical properties on several levels. Just throwing a couple of more, let's say, regular things, what we are doing, into my lecture. This is, we are very specialized in the meantime also in double curved things and facades made out of not only glass but also fiber cement and other materials. This is a building we did with the team of Zaha Hadid. This is the new National Museum of Qatar, a design from Jean Nouvel from Paris, which is so hyper complicated that even our very experienced team is at the limit of their abilities. This thing is the biggest BIM model ever created. The data number is so excessively huge that it needs a specialized company doing nothing else than sorting and storing the data. Now, if you look at all these disks here, which are somehow thrown against and into each other, they are not just disks, their surface is quite irregular and the patterning is even more irregular. Very irregular. This is the museum for Enzo Ferrari, the famous car builder. Enzo was born here. This was his first shop where he started to invent the cars, the Ferrari cars, and once he died, the company decided to build a museum here. It was the last building designed by Jan Kablitzky from Future Systems. And we did the entire engineering, forming this car body type surface here and the new Ferrari yellow out of aluminum, very, very smoothly curved in a way that you can do it, that you can produce it, and then you can pay for it. It was, of course, relatively expensive, but still affordable. There's, of course, no right angle, no orthogonal. Everything is curved in space. But now if you look at these details here, and imagine this is all aluminum plates designed with so much care and precision. So this is our daily work. What is? I'm the only architect. Now, in this case, I'm the architect. A couple of years ago, I got a phone call at 5 o'clock in the evening between two lectures. The secretary came and said, okay, the Vatican wants to talk to you. Vaticano, okay. But I said, okay, I left the Catholic Church already 15 years ago. Maybe there's something rude going on. And they said, no, they want to talk to you. They are quite friendly. So I picked up the phone, and then there was the direct question, would you be ready to design a canopy for the Pope? So what would you say? I said, yes. So this was the canopy. So the canopy, this was the first one, which is about 1,500 square meters of textile, standing there for 2.5 hours, shading the Pope, plus 60 bishops and cardinals, plus the safety people, plus, giving a public mass, which was TV'd to 1.5 billion people, and there were 250 people in front of the podium. It is not allowed that any safety or security personnel is visible, so they're all hidden like bishops. There is no cameraman allowed, so all cameras have to be automatic, and they have to disappear once someone approaches them. So this, for example, in these steps, there were, I think, in total 4 or 5 cameras sunken in. So the flat step flips up, an automatic camera comes out, takes the picture, and as soon as the popes come closer and closer, the camera disappears, the step flaps downwards, and he traps on it. So this was the second one. You have to imagine this is 70 meters by 70 meters, two stories high. It cantilevers 35 meters. There are 160 people sitting below. The Pope does not allow to have a bulletproof screen in front of him. There is about 150,000 people here. So if you cannot check them. If one has a gun and shoots to the Pope, he will be just hit it. So the philosophy is then to pull him behind the altar. There's a 3 by 3 meter hydraulic part of the floor, lifts him directly downwards in an urgency operation situation. This is all installed there. The entire thing is full with techniques. Toilets is the simplest one. Urgency operation is the more complicated one. It stands there for 2.5 hours. So we said, if we design this, being the architects and the engineers, we want to design something where no gram of material is left over, no gram. So we find in place a meadow. We have an installation time of 2 weeks. We have a de-installation time, I call that a decomposition time, of another week. And after those 3 weeks, there is nothing left over there, even the same mice crawling over the green. So what we did is we designed everything to be built up from regular scaffolding, building scaffolding here. This is bridge scaffolding because of the cantilevers and the huge loads. All the functions inside are containers which have been rented. All the surfaces here is wood, which is not painted. And this is textiles spanning over wooden frames, huge sizes which are just clipped onto the scaffolding. Even the altar, even the chair where the Pope was sitting on, was a reused altar from the first installation 4 years ago. So it was more or less a recycled thing. It worked perfectly. It was totally decomposed. I'm sorry, what is this now? Okay. The only thing left over was the textile here, a couple of thousand square meters of textile. And what we did is we made handbags out of them, put a stamp on it. I was a part of the canopy of the Pope, 2000 and so and so, in Freiburg, Germany. And we sold them, made a lot of money. And then gave this to a SOS children village as a support. So this really works. Typically for such a pavilion, let's call it pavilion, you have a design and engineering time of maximum 3 months. So it's quite a hard job to not only make it fully functionable and to install all that stuff which has been taken from Baroque and other churches all over Germany, to install it in a way that is not undergoing any weathering and that it can be brought back to the church, that you can clip these things away, that you have a lighting system here which fulfills all the requirements of international TV standards, etc., etc. This is the recycled altar. You see it's also cladded with textile. This is the chair. Everything reused multiple times. Now, coming back to the more, let's say, daily life issues. This is a typical German passive house. Huh? Maybe they look everywhere the same way. What is passive house? We talked about it 40 minutes ago when I said that a couple of Central European governments introduced a law which prescribes the stepwise reduction of the primary heating energy consumption. What was the answer? Nobody knew how to do that. The answer was wrap a lot of styrofoam and other materials around your building, make the windows small, and make the building airtight. The name of it is Passive House, which in its principle is a great idea, to come up with, let's say, a certain number for the energy consumption. The first idea is good. The step number two means prescribing how to do that, prescribing that the windows have not to exceed a U value of, that the walls have not to exceed a U value of, that the thing has to be airtight. This was the big mistake which is out there since more than 20 years. because this mistake blocked any innovation. German government said, okay, we are reaching out for the passive house standard. If you are a low-income family, young family, kids, no money, you get tax reduction, you get support money, but only if you fulfill the passive house standard. If you do a building which is even better, energy-wise, but does not have air tightness, you don't get the financial support. So in order to get some money from the government where everyone is reaching out for, you have to make the decision that you want to live in an airtight box, where you might die of your own exhalations in case the tiny blower in the bathroom gives up. So I said, this is the one thing I will never do in my life. Never. Living in an airtight box. And living in a house with such small windows that they limit your views. I mean, you're becoming depressive if you live in such a styrofoam box. So I said, we have to work on the opposite. Not something which is airtight, but something which is maybe sometimes airtight, but of course not in summertime. Something which has only windows and not small ones, and something where we overcome other problems with these insulations I'm just going to talk about. See, this is the reality in Germany. This was a house built 100 years ago, nice sandstone here and so on. Then the people, the inhabitants, decided to save some energy. In order to get some financial support, they wrapped styrofoam around it, plus plastering and whatever. So they somehow managed here, but when it came down to the sandstone basement here and to the entrance door, the architect somehow failed and they said, okay, let's stop here because we don't know how to do it here. So this is the result. Now we look a little bit closer at it from the scientific standpoint. We analyze a perimeter wall of a typical Central European residential building and we find out there's between 15 and 25 materials glued together. Glued together in a way that you have, being the architect, the engineer, the contractor, no liability problem because the thing sticks together forever. But that means what we are creating here is nothing else than special, not to say toxic waste. Because the point in time when you somehow either tear the building down or add something or remodel something, etc., is the point in time where you have to take all that stuff away. What are you going to do with that? It's a composite structure. Okay, there's the term of thermal recycling, means burn the stuff, but running out of oil and knowing about this and then burning styrofoam and other materials, polyurethane foams, is not really an acceptable and morally fundable approach. I say, why not this? I already said that in 1990. If the German car industry is able to design cars and to produce them, which actually the new Mercedes S-Class is 95% recyclable, and then we then face the fact that the building industry stands for 60% of waste in this world, I think we have to do something. We cannot proceed as we do with high glossy, whatever, blobby designs and so on. This is all, just forget about it and take the responsibility you have to take facing the problems which are coming up at the horizon. But to do so, to build a house which fulfills the 100% recyclability codex, means you have to violate codes and other whatever, professional. But however, I did so. So this is the first recyclable building of the modern time. It stands in old Europe. I think old Europe is something which is a really good term where you can be proud of it. It's a zero energy, zero emission, 100% recyclable building. The first one beyond the mud hut. It was quite difficult. It took me 3 years to design it. But now we erected it in 2000. We live in it since 14 years. And once you live in such a building, you will never move out. Definitely not. Overcoming these toxic waste stuff up means that you have no cables in the wall. Oh God. If you have no cables in the wall, there's no light switches in the wall. Etc., etc. So this building has no door handles, it has no light switches, it has no cables in the walls. Everything is totally flexible. In a very excessive interpretation, even the bathtub, which is here, is on sliders, and you have four water-in, water-out pipes, which are flexible, and you can detach them, and then you roll the bathtub, of course, without water to another spot, and plug just the four into the water wastewater supply and take the bath somewhere else. This is the positive side effect of it. But since then, since we realized that these buildings are not only shining examples on how, or let's say, this is not the solution for tomorrow, of course not, because you cannot build glassy buildings everywhere, but they have a technique and they have a philosophy behind them, which is applicable to every side of this world. Since then, we design one experimental residential building per year. This is not bad either. This is 130% of energy production. It's very, very simple. It's about 90% recyclability. It is absolutely luxurious and in the same time affordable. It has floor heating, but the heating in the different rooms has a different temperature, so that you, closing your eyes and walking bare feet, know where you are just by the temperature of the floor. I'm talking about non-visual architecture. I talk about tactility, surfaces which you might touch or not, temperatures you feel or not, and other things. This is a building, this is a competition we won for the German government. It is a showcase in Berlin. The building is split in two parts. The part we are looking at is the public part. There is no fence, nothing in. People might walk directly to the facade. They are protected from rain and snow by this huge roof here. Here are flat screens embedded in the walls which tell the visitor the story of what is a zero energy plus energy house, how does this work, what is energy production, what is harvesting, what is energy consumption, etc., etc. This is the energy room. And beyond this wall, this is the area where the so-called tested family lives. So people have no access, even no visual access, to their living space. They live there for free, 12 months each family. They are monitored in their behavior, so it's less worse than what NSA and other related companies are doing with their monitoring. And therefore, they live for free. But we, being the scientists, get lots of data of their behavior, how they treat the building, and what the building does. However, this building is still somehow, let's say, non-adaptive, but it produces 170% of the energy it consumes. The excess energy is taken to feed two cars. One is present here, which is an electro-smart. There's a second electro-smart. There's also an electric bike. And the building communicates with the cars without having the inhabitant taking any action. The building knows, okay, I have an energy overproduction. Where is the car? When does the car come home? Should I feed the batteries aside the house, or should I wait and feed the car then? Very, very successful. Stands there now since 4 years. Of course, the building, since it stands there for a limited period in time, has to be fully recyclable. It has to fulfill all German codes. So this is the flooring system, where there is no drop of glue or other wet connecting parts, where there is no composite action this just layered one on top of the other, every material is identifiable so that you can recycle it at the end of its lifetime, whenever this might be. In this case, it will be in 5 years. For other buildings, it might be 50 or 500, but we will not decide when our buildings are going to disappear. This is the next generations. The only thing we are able to decide is that our buildings have to leave the planet with honesty and not creating hundreds of thousands of tons of toxic waste. So now, this is the last approach. Now, the last chapter, we are done in 5 minutes. If you ask the question once more about this non-constant inside action of the inhabitants, being present or not, being singular or the entire family, active or sleeping, if you take this, if you want to overcome this problem with the constant physical properties, you need an adaptive skin. If you need to feed the inhabitants with warmth, or cool air or fresh air and so on, you need an energy system which somehow can react to this plus to this. So you need something which can predict what is going to happen. If the people are absent, the room is cool. When the people are home, the room should be warm. It should not be the person which then drives up the heating, because then it takes you 1 hour until it gets warm. At the point in time when you come home, it has to be warm. Not earlier and not later, but how do you know? You know when you're going to come home because of your outlook or whatever, the position of your car. But what does the heating or cooling system do? How is a heating or cooling system able to heat up a house or even a single room in such a way that the temperature is exact the one you want to have once you enter the room? You need something which is taking the weather prediction. You need something which perfectly knows the thermal behavior of your house as well as the performance of your heating, cooling, venting devices. So if you want to describe this, you need minimum 10 scientists for 1 year to program your apartment. Means you pay $200,000 in order to save $500 per year. So this is not the right path. So what we did is we said, why don't we create something which is a self-learning thing, yeah? A small box, small size like this. You buy that, you plug it into the internet, and this automatically connects to the next meteo station. And continuously know about the weather, temperature, wind, humidity, what's going on outside, and knows the weather prediction for the upcoming days. Quite simple. And then you have a thermometer, also measuring the CO2, the humidity, the light intensity in your room, of course wireless, which you plug on the wall. And now this box compares the temperatures inside and the temperatures outside, the weather inside and the weather outside. And after maximum 3 days, the algorithms here, which are patented and super complicated, predict to 95% precision the thermal dynamical behavior of your house without any scientists. Just by watching the changes outside, the changes inside, and then recalculating what obviously are the thermodynamical properties of the thing in between. Once you know this, then you of course are able to predict the point in time when heating should start, so that you exactly at the return point of the inhabitants have the temperature you want. We call that intelligent building automation. However, it should be the scientist who is intelligent, but this is the term out there. Now, if you do that in a clever way, it just costs you around 10 euro per square meter. Sorry to talk about money in that school, but I think it is, sometimes it is necessary to just make you conscious what we are doing. If we talk an insulation about of the outer wall, so wrapping styrofoam and other stuff around the building, you talk about 82. costs. The savings are relatively big, but the cost to saving margin is very, very small compared to this. So now if you remember the 1,400 billion euro needed to retrofit the German already existing residential buildings, this sum which is unpayable because it is based on these actions here. It is very, very obvious that we should not do that any longer, but do something like this. Of course, not saving 70%, but 20 to 40, with an invest which is only a fraction of the other one, and with the guarantee that you can pay it. The other one is just a chimera, as we say. So this is then the target, and this already exists now. In the meantime, a group of former students of mine, they did the company, and now they have the system running. This is the central unit, which just by radio signals communicates with everything else, also the next meteor station, etc., and then heats up the system in time. So by, maybe this is one of the last slides and a little bit scientific, it's also in German, sorry. But what do we do here? It's very simple. We analyze the thermal behavior of the building by doing what? This is outside. This is the perimeter wall. This is inside, maybe a sleeping room. This is a partition. This might be the kitchen. This is a big, I don't know what happens. This is a big inner wall separating two apartments, for example, from each other. This person here has a constant room temperature. The person here has a room temperature which is adjusted to the points of presence or absence. The presence is these peaks that's predicted by putting your data in your cell phone or wherever, and this is the absence. In the absence, it's not getting that much cold because the man here has some goldfishes in his apartment. So 16 degrees. But just raising the temperature from 60 to 22 to 16 to 22, etc., over the period, over the day, saves you up to 40% of energy. And now we are going to trace how these curves behave. Here we have warming up and cooling down. You see what happens to the inner temperature over the day. This is what the movie shows. So now we heat it up. See, the temperature is warm as the neighbor. Now we are absent. The temperature is sinking downwards again. And from the observation of those temperature changes, the system recalculates the properties. And now, if you have a constant temperature in your apartment, but the outside temperature varies, of course the temperature within the wall varies, you need a certain amount of energy, which then ends here about 6 kilowatt hours per day, constant heating. Now, we have this variable heating, adaptive heating, where we predict once we are present and absent, and now the system heats it up here. The point in time you are home, the temperature is there, you are leaving, the temperature falls down again. Now we start heating. You are not home yet, but the system starts up, hits the point in time. This is the temperature you wish, even with that cold outside. That's all. The saving is 40%. The investment is more or less nothing, managed from your iPhone or whatever. So now we take this, and we say, okay, now we combine. This May, we are going to install this pavilion-type building, which stands in the famous Weißenhof-Siedlung, built in 1927, under the leadership of Mies van der Rohe, where we have buildings of Marzdam, of Le Corbusier and all the famous heroes of the 20th, which was a building exhibition, trying to, let's say, show how we could and should live tomorrow. In World War II, a couple of those buildings have been bombed away. Since people could not find the drawings anymore, there was one piece of wasteland now for 70 years. Everything is national monument and protected. And we got the allowance to build a building there as a showcase for 3 years. So it has no foundations, there is no wiring and piping in the ground because of recyclability things. The entire building is recyclable. And here we install very futuristic things. We have a paper wall heating, means it's a carbon nanofibers within a sheet of paper, and you apply some electricity and the paper gets warm up to 500 degrees Celsius. So the heating is now half a millimeter thick. We have photovoltaics in the roof. We have also solar absorbers. This building produces 200% of the energy it needs. It feeds, again, two electric cars from Daimler. It has a couple of other features which are quite funny. And there's still excess energy. And now we are using this alpha system not only to run the energy production and the energy consumption over the day, and not only to communicate with the cars, which this system also does, but in the first time ever, this new house communicates with an existing building designed by Le Corbusier 90 years ago. And since the landmark protected existing building cannot be thermally insulated outside or inside, this is an energetic sink, of course. It is the hell when we talk about energetic consumption. But we introduced the principle of sisterhood, where we said the strong sister has to support the weak one, and the 200% has to support the other one. And in order to balance energy harvesting, storage, consumption of the two buildings, plus the two cars, we need that system in the background. The data of which follow the German bank code means there is no access to any personal data, and even our famous administrations like NSA and other ones have no chance to crack something. We have a lot of fun here. This is the first time ever where we work with in the world. I'm not for records, but just to give you an idea how difficult and complicated it is. This is the first time ever where we have floor-to-floor high vacuum glazing. There is vacuum glazing out there in this size, but here we apply it for the very first time. The U value of that vacuum glass should be 0.3. This is far below what is achievable for triple glazing with krypton filling. Another nice thing, so I already told you, you always must have fun. Huh? The smart might drive inside the house. And then you can unpack the beer bottles, the six packs, and whatever you bought. You might move grandma in. Then turn the car. There's a rotating platform. And then full speed drive outwards, but of course open the door before. So we are looking forward to that building. I think it might be another contribution, another step on the long way we have to go. I would be happy if the one or the other idea I was presenting here would have found your interest or falls on fruitful grounds. This is the way we are working. However, I'm only the presenter. The people behind me are the ones having the ideas and doing the work. So always consider that it was not me, but them. Thank you very much. Thank you. Thanks. I'm still here, so if there's something important, I'm
Does
ready.
Does anybody have a burning question?
No burning question.
No burning.
I talked a little bit too long, I'm sorry for this, but since no one fell asleep, I thought, okay, it might be interesting. I normally stop as soon as someone falls asleep. You closed your eyes, I saw that.
There's only a few minutes.
Yeah.
The intelligent house system concept has been around for quite a few years now, right? There are quite a few experimental houses that's built based on that concept, but why is it not implemented in any like actual housing project so far, or is it implemented already? I'm not sure.
This system I was talking about is now installed in about 200 buildings. It traces back to an idea I had 15 years ago, maybe 12 years ago. Then we researched on that, developed the algorithms on how to describe this, the thermodynamical behavior of something, which you never see. It's just by observing data, sets of data, dynamically. And then I found this group of students which was willing to create that startup and to go some risk. And since about 2 years, 2.5 years, the system is out there. So they had a lot of test applications in order to make it robust. And now since a couple of months, they are going to sell it. Yeah, and this is the big difference to whatever, to Nest, which has been bought by Google to buy whatever it was, 30 millions or billions or so. There are big differences to the automation systems out there in the market. Number one is no one, because this system has the patents worldwide for it, is taking advantage of the prediction of the weather forecast, and no one can calculate the physical properties of the building with these algorithms. No one can do what we call, Schimmelpilz. What is Schimmelpilz? I'm so sorry, fungus. If you have condensation fungus, no one can predict fungus, the danger of fungus, because this is also protected by the patents of someone else. And the system is totally wireless. You do not, this is non-invasive. There is no wiring or so. You just take it and nail it on the wall or glue it or whatever. Put it on your furniture. And then it installs itself. It's a self-organizing, self-learning thing.
So the architecture by the end is the program?
Do you think?
The architectural product by the end is the program, do you think? Or because it's just a device that you can put into
it
any...
It's just a device.
So it can be implemented into existing house?
Yes. Or in new ones. This is just a device, but it is an essential part of our work in the meantime. Other essential parts are fabric spanning over a wooden box. So we say the house is made out of wood. Makes some sense, especially since it is only allowed to stay there for 3 years. But what to do with the surface? Either you paint it, make it waterproof with fungicides and insecticides and or you put some plaster and styrofoam on top of it, make a composite structure out of it, and then you have the same recycling problems as before. So we said there is wood and there is no painting on the wood. There is no single layer. It is sheer wood. One outside, one inside. There is an in-between filling of vacuum-insulated panels. And in order to protect the wood from humidity, we have 80 millimeters apart from the exterior surface of the wood, an open fabric spanning all around the building. So the fabric is open to be breathable, but the openness is such that if the rain really hits the fabric hard, there's some humidity penetrating and a little bit is hitting once or twice a year the wooden surface. But since the space in between is vented, naturally vented, the wood dries out within a few minutes. So this is what we are applying. Or foundations which are not made out of concrete, which can be placed there and taken away easily. Or wallpapers which are not glued onto the walls but spanned like a cotton weaving on a painter's wooden frame, and which if you apply a little bit of electricity, warm up. Immediately, in a second, the thing is warm within a second. And you can take advantage of this radiative heat, etc., etc. There is plenty of stuff in there, in these buildings. And these are the methods and the tools which we offer to the society of colleagues to implement them in their buildings, which might look as you want. This is just our style.
Sorry, I got one more question.
Yeah.
So by then, is who's the one that's running that program? For example, is it a company, or is So it would be like something like a Google company that would be controlling.
This is 20 young people undergoing the German data protection code, which is different from other countries. And the data protection follows the code the German banks have to fulfill. So there's a complete separation between the action taken, the data measured, and name and address. There's no one in the world which can bring those data together. It's also not needed.
How adaptable would that be for the individual? For example, like for that program, if you implement it, like how do you change it? For example, in most of the houses, if you design something and you wanted to change it, you can. There are many ways for you to. Like there are many styles.
You can download that from the internet, but there is no relation between your address and what you are doing. This is a very complicated thing, don't ask me. But there is, how do you call that, a certificate to it.
Are there any other questions?
All hands are going up now.
Is there still oxygen in the room here?
I don't know if it's too complex or if you've already touched on it sufficiently, but just having come back like from a small engineering background, like just the fundamental principle of always having insulation, like density in order to insulate. And I don't know if you're doing it like you suggested between with all this material between and this thin piece of wood, whether it's like you said through ventilation or actual like heating of air in a vacuum packed situation. But if it is just through that cotton heating, I'm just not sure where you're gaining the density, because even if it is on a responsive kind of weather pattern, and there is that, but there's also the traditional weather patterns that always exist. And I just wondered, I mean, I don't know if because of this adaptability you're gaining, I don't know how many degrees or what you're gaining, but I'm not sure how. Even in the bigger buildings, where it's just a single piece of insulation, what's actually in that fabric that's allowing it to insulate and to hold heat, and not to transfer? Like, I'm not sure what properties are creating that.
I'm not really sure whether I fully understood what you mean. You're talking about this house and this exterior fabric, is that right?
Yeah.
Then related to the question of insulation.
Yeah, I can ask you afterwards as well. It's also. Fine, but yeah, just I don't know how the heat is actually being trapped.
Okay. So behind this open weave fabric, which sits about 80 millimeter in front of the non-treated wooden surface, there's just air. The fabric has only two jobs to fulfill. The one is look nice, and the other one allow breathability to that cavity, to that interspace. Since it is open, punched, it allows for, let's say, if it rains and at the same time you have high wind speeds, it allows for a certain penetration of the drops hitting the surface. This is of course, but there's on the one hand side the 80 millimeter cavity, and so most of the liquidity falls already down. We do actual one-to-one tests with that, and the droplets still running through, they stick on the wooden surface, but they are so small and such a few of them that they just dry away because of this venting of the interspace. So this is all you see. Now, we have the outer wooden, let's say, layer, and there's an inner one, and in between we have the wooden post to take the load and to connect the outer and the inner layer. And then we have very regular, but natural fiber-based insulation in between, insulation packages. Normally, it would necessitate to have walls of that thickness. So what we do, we reduce it to that. We have 20 centimeters of, what is this, hanf? That is where you make hashish out of it, yeah? Okay. Hanf fibers, natural ones. And then you have 20 millimeters additional layer of vacuum insulated panels. and a combination of both gives you an extremely high insulation quality.
Thank you. It actually reminds you of those Nike running tops that whip the sweat off you and act in that way. So, yeah, thanks. It sounds like a big club.
Okay. I think we should let you
maybe one last question.
One more question.
Oh, no. Yeah, one more.
I just wondered whether you would kind of marry the idea of form active structure, like structurally form active, like you talked about Fry Otto, and some of your structures at the beginning showed, you know, curved, and you know the idea of curvature bringing structural stability, like the dome,
yeah.
The shell. And now these energy efficient buildings are very orthogonal.
Yeah.
Is it because you mentioned briefly, well, this is our style. Is it your style, or is it because it's easier to kind of for now handle, you know, the layering of the different materials and the recyclability? Is there a next generation that might consider form activity?
It is not fair to ask that question because it's the thing I'm struggling and fighting with since 30 years.
It's too much asked
since
for,
I left
isn't
school.
It? Yeah, I just wondered if there is an intention.
Okay, there is a very high logic with the orthogonal buildings.
Yeah.
In many cases, they make a lot of sense. Eh?
Yeah.
If you want to hang a piece of art on the wall, a biomorphic surface is not that ideal. And if you want to walk on a somehow surface, a plain one has really advantages, especially if you are a little bit sleepy and whatever. Eh? So the question has to be asked, why this biomorphism? Because we now have the right programs for it? Or because we now can realize something we could not imagine in our limited brain 30 years ago, where we had to do tiny experiments to somehow understand, like Fry Otto did? I'm not that much sure, and I very often doubt, even if there are breathtaking, beautiful, shining examples of this type of architecture, I very often turn around and ask myself the question, okay, is this the direction to go to, or is this just a superb sculpturing, which is, let's say, limited to a few people which are really having the ability to sculpture? See, when Zaha Hadid or Jean Nouvel or other ones are doing that, it typically is something which is an entity. If there is a less qualified person out there doing this, latest, if you look at the entrance door, you realize that he is unable to treat it. Because the thing looks like this from distance and looks like this when you stand in front of it.
Mm.
But turning all these trivial tools like a door or a window or what a door handle or so into something which totally fulfills this cultural requirements is the one thing. But the other one is beyond this cultural idea, which is totally okay. Why are we doing it? Is it the thing to do in every hut and production building, or is it? I'm having a contract for a design to design a residential building in a region where they have average minimum 2 days a week, 120, 130 kilometers an hour wind speed. It's like designing a residential building in a wind tunnel. And there you cannot do that. Definitely not. But coming up with what we call in German a Leistungsform, means a shape which is so consequent, like being a Formula One car or a double sonic aircraft's surface, is something which, of course, we, having the engineering qualification, are able to do. But when it comes to the interior, then you are still standing in front of the same mess.
I have the question regarding the timber shell structure, where you were dealing with internal forces, stresses, counterbalancing it by displacements of the support. Do you have any commercial structure with that kind of solution? Or the second question is how you are dealing with regulations and basically the structure.
The question is fully okay.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, sorry.
So there is no commercial application yet, because I already said it is the most noble job of a university professor to reach in the world of the unknown and the world of the day after tomorrow. Since we face those problems of having 2.2 billion kids out there which want to have a habitat, etc., etc., we cannot continue doing what we did in the last decades. And we take the position that we are the ones taking a very radical approach. We do not make the things more efficient, we make them more effective. Means we do not do the wrong things a little bit less wrong. We do it in a total other approach. And this is just one idea. However, I, being the chief researcher, had to collect about 1 million euro to make that working. And the question from the sponsors is, okay, is there any kickback sometime on the time axis of our efforts here? And there is, of course, because there is a very urgent applicability of those things already out there, which could be an endless business. This is related to German Autobahn bridges, which are totally fatigued load, and where you in the meantime have to decrease the allowable speed to 60 kilometers an hour, 80 kilometers an hour, because the damage of a bridge by fatigue has increased by a level which was never predicted in the rich times of the 70s when those bridges had been built. At those times we had the Iron Wall, there was no Netherlands truck, no Belgium truck on German roads, more or less. Now they are all driving from Amsterdam and Rotterdam from the big harbors across Germany to Poland and then to the Ukraine and Russia. And one truck has a damaging effect of 150,000 regular cars. So forget about the cars, just look at the trucks. But in the meantime, a German east-west Autobahn with three lanes, two lanes are occupied by trucks. So now if you have this loading of the bridge girders induced by the trucks, and if you then counterbalance this by lifting and lowering the supports, then can you dramatically reduce that effect? So this is one thing, one example.
Well,
good. Now we
thank
start.
You very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.